Hi, I'm Cari Rincker of Rincker Law, and today I'm going to be interviewing a very special guest. We have Ruth Wyman here from the Champaign-Urbana community. She's also a fellow family lawyer here. So, Ruth, why don't you tell us a little bit about yourself? And I understand you are also running for judge. Is that correct?
I am. So I have lived in this community for more than 25 years. I came here to study as an undergrad in 1991 and just stayed here, never ended up leaving. And in 2001, I started law school. And then in 2004 graduated, became licensed, and have been practicing law ever since. So next month it'll be my 15-year anniversary.
And you don't just do family laws, isn't that right? You also do, is it criminal law, some other areas?
Right. I actually do all sorts of areas, everything. I've done criminal jury trials, misdemeanor traffic cases, family law, lots of orders of protection, custody cases. And then I've done some juvenile abuse and neglect, probate cases. Essentially, all of the different courtrooms in Champaign County Courthouse I've been in for one type of case or another.
You have a more eclectic law practice than I do, and I know that I have a wide base. So let's walk backwards just a little bit. Where did you say that you grew up?
I grew up in Normal, just an hour away. My parents are teachers. They're now retired, but sort of just grew up there, went to the public schools, and then came to the U of I to do my education, both my undergrad and my law degree.
Okay, excellent. And you have your own law practice. How long have you had your own practice?
For 8 years. I originally started practicing with Robert Kirshner Law Office, and that was in 2004. Actually, I worked for him and with him before I got my law license, just as a clerk. And then once I got my law license, I was an associate. He passed away in 2011. And after that, I decided to open my own practice.
So I'm going to have to, why did you even decide to be a lawyer? I love the answers to the questions. They're so diverse whenever I interview attorneys.
Sure. Well, I had worked over this several years before then, actually since probably 1994 or so, for the tenant union, helping tenants who had problems with their landlords, had questions about renting, wanted to get their security deposits back. And I had also been active with the National Organization for Women and the local chapter and the state chapter.
And this is why you were in college?
Well, I was in college and then after college. Also, okay. I worked for the tenant union, and then I volunteered and was on the board of the Champaign County chapter of the National Organization for Women. And so from that, I got a lot of experience and understanding about the importance of having someone who could advocate for you, because tenants and other people, sometimes they just don't have the money, they don't have the resources, they don't understand the law so well. And I thought, I want to advocate and I want to be able to help people out. And I thought going to law school and becoming an attorney would be an effective way to help out really people who had been marginalized in the society.
Excellent. So I know that you have some experience as a public servant. Can you tell me a little bit more about that?
Sure. Well, I've had experience both in working in the community or for various not-for-profit organizations and volunteering with them, and also serving on local boards for different not-for-profits. Currently, I am president of the Urbana Free Library Foundation, so we raise money for the Urbana Free Library programs. Mm-hmm. I'm also on the board of the Champaign-Urbana Tenant Union and on the steering committee for the ACLU here in Champaign County. I've volunteered for the Champaign County Healthcare Consumers, and actually before I started law school, helped with the appellate court case where Robert Kirshner was the lead attorney when one of the hospitals wanted to shut down the Medicare 100 program. And so I helped do some research. I couldn't be a lawyer because I wasn't licensed at the time, but I helped to do research, as did a couple other volunteers. And we were successful in keeping the Medicare 100 program. So I sort of saw from that perspective, again, the advocacy work that can really help people who otherwise wouldn't be able to get through things.
What's your advice for people that want to get more involved in the community or become a public servant, but they don't really know where to start or even who to reach out to?
Yeah, I think part is looking at and researching different organizations. There are so many wonderful community organizations in Champaign-Urbana and throughout Champaign County. And so part of it is, I think, looking at and contacting organizations saying, hey, I'd like to volunteer, and maybe even shadowing a worker or a volunteer to sort of see what the organization does. And then, volunteering, depending on the amount of time, either help helping out, whether it's a couple hours at the food bank or being on a board and helping out with a fundraising event for the Urbana Free Library Foundation or the Champaign Public Library, or any other number of organizations. There's often a volunteer coordinator who you can talk with, and then gradually sort of picking a couple organizations that you really support, maybe ones that have helped you or helped out neighbors, and looking at that personal connection and how you can be of help, even if it's only a couple hours a month.
So I know you've definitely had a very servant attitude with your law practice, and you do quite a bit of pro bono work, which, you know, I certainly admire. Can you tell me a little bit more about that?
Sure. When I worked originally with Robert Kirshner Law Office, we did several sort of high profile pro bono cases, helping out people, one person in particular, where a local organization said, hey, we think this person was convicted, he shouldn't have been, and so we did the post-conviction, or we did the post-trial motion, won on the post-trial motion, then did the trial, and I think we charged the client $1 for that. I think it was, but that was important, and it was probably $10,000 worth of work, but that was important to do, and important for the community to see that justice can be done. I have done a lot of, since I started my own office, a lot of pro bono work. It's probably about half of a work week, every week, in doing work for clients who can't afford the pay.
Wow, that's impressive. That's a lot.
It is, and sometimes it's overwhelming, but in the end, it's always very rewarding. It's the clients, many of them, because I'm fluent in Spanish, many of them are can't speak English, and so I'm able to represent them in speaking Spanish. Many of them are undocumented immigrants, and so can't get legal help from other entities that might otherwise be able to help, but because of their funding requirements, can only help citizens. I get referrals from Courage Connection, the domestic violence shelter, and so when I've gotten referrals there, I'll help them, and it's either to do it for free or to do it for a reduced rate or to take it for, you know, a small amount of money and then just see it through. It's a lot of work, but again, it's so rewarding.
I'm so jealous that you know Spanish and can speak it well. When I'm asked about my biggest regrets educationally, it is that I did not pursue Spanish. Yeah. And so when did you learn Spanish and develop that skill?
Well, I think that was when I was much younger. My mother actually escaped from Nazi Germany, but went to Chile, was accepted with her family in Chile when she was 4 years old. And so she grew up speaking Spanish with friends, and then speaking German at home and English in the going to school. And so then she met my father, and they moved to the U.S., and then they had my brother, my twin sister, and I. We didn't speak much Spanish at home, but we learned it. We started taking classes in fourth or fifth grade at our school, and then I took it more in high school. In college, I did a study abroad in Chile for a summer, and so that really helped a lot with my language. And then my husband, who I met how many years ago? Probably 16, 17 years ago. He's from Mexico. We met while he was doing a Fulbright here at the U of I. And so we decided we would speak Spanish between ourselves. And then with our 10-year-old daughter, we speak Spanish at home. So it keeps the practice up.
So to shift gears and talk about your race for a judge, how do you think that those skills and experiences can transfer to the bench?
So part of what I think I bring to the bench that other candidates maybe don't bring so well is this broad experience in the community. Having served on boards and commissions, having served on the Urbana City Council for 8 years back when I was 23, those experiences and representing new immigrants who have come here, people who don't speak English as a first language or even as a second language, it's sometimes their third if they can speak at all. It's that knowledge and understanding of the entire community rather than just a small section of the community. So I think that really helps. And the interactions I've had in volunteering for so many different organizations over the past 2.5 decades.
So why do you want to run for judge, Ruth?
Well, I think it's important to have someone with my experience and my perspectives on the bench. I have experience in every area of law that a circuit judge presides over. That is different, I think, than any of the other candidates who are running for the resident circuit judge seat. So I do regularly practice criminal defense. I regularly practice family law. I have probate cases, traffic, misdemeanor cases. And the other thing is that I represent and have represented both sides of cases. Mm-hmm. Now I represent victims of domestic violence and I represent people who are accused of committing domestic violence. And so I think when you've represented both sides of issues, you tend to learn more. What are the different arguments? What are the facts that are really important in a case? And so I think that's important. And then additionally, I do appellate work. So I actually today I have an appellate court brief due that I'll do work, finish working on when we finish the podcast. But it's knowing sort of what the appellate court will look for in an appeal. And I think that's important in protecting a record. When a client finishes a case, they want it to be done. And if a judge doesn't make rulings based on the law and make that clear, that explicit, then it becomes sort of less likely that it'll survive an appeal. And so I think that's important to make sure that the clients, the parties, protect the record for appeal, but also that the judge, in making her ruling, make sure that the record on appeal is for appeal is protected.
Oh, that's a really good point. So, you know, I lived and I practiced law in New York City for about a decade. Mm-hmm. And so the judgeships and the campaign and all of this is very different for me than what I had in New York. There was a committee that sort of appointed various judges, and that was the only name on the ballot. So this is all very new to me. Mm-hmm. So could you just explain a little bit how campaigns are run here in Illinois, and specifically in Champaign County?
Sure. So under Illinois law, judges are elected partisan. That is, they run as a Democrat, Republican, Green, Libertarian, that sort of thing. But the opening only comes up for circuit judge when someone who is a circuit judge retires or decides to not run for retention. That's happening in two separate seats here this year, different from in the past. I don't remember the last time we ever had two seats open. One is a resident seat. That means they run only in Champaign County. Only Champaign County voters vote for them. That's the seat I'm running for. Mm-hmm. The other seat currently occupied by Judge DeFonis is a circuit-wide seat, all six counties. And that's the one.
How is that decided, though? And how many seats are resident seats versus circuit-wide seats?
So it differs by county, and it's when you run, I guess, under the 1970 Constitution, they must have decided each county is going to get this number of seats. I believe that there are three different resident seats and three different circuit-wide seats. And so when that judge who is in that type of seat retires or elects not to run for retention, that if you're running, that's your seat, the seat you're running for, the resident. So I'm running for the resident seat. There are three other people in the Democratic Party running for the Democratic nomination with me, and then one Republican who's running, and then one Democrat and one Republican who are running for the circuit-wide seat that Judge DeFonis is retiring from.
So why should judge positions even have a party associated with it?
I'm not sure that they should. But I didn't get to decide the law. So it's sort of like, it's when you, like when your clients say, why does this happen? Well, it's because it's the law, you know, mm-hmm. and as a judge, you don't get to make the law. You follow the law and you enforce the law. And so why is it? It's that way because that's what the legislature decided. Will it stay that way? I don't know. There's got to be pressure on the legislature to change that.
So if you're elected, how long will your term be?
So if you're elected, then you run for retention every 6 years. And so it's a little bit different because when you run for retention, you don't run as a Democrat or Republican. You simply are on the ballot and not against anyone. Just should this judge be retained, yes or no? Mm-hmm. So generally, judges are retained when they're voted on. I think it's every 6 years.
Okay. All right. And what experiences do you have that you think best equip you to be on the bench?
Well, the experience in having, if from day one, I'll be able to address any of the different issues where I'm put into. Now, normally, I think the circuit judges are placed in a certain area. You're supposed to do one, two, or three different issues. But the truth is, there are motions for substitution of judge. There are judges that get sick or have other obligations. Mm-hmm. And so I would be able to cover any of the different areas of law. And I think that's what makes me most well-equipped, especially compared to my opponents, to do that because of my wide range of experience over the last nearly 15 years. The other is that my experience in the community and my sort of knowledge of the community. I understand and I believe that everyone's voice needs to be heard. And I've seen, as I'm sure you have as well in the courtroom, it's often that those people who are marginalized in the community, they're marginalized in the courthouse too. And what's important is that we follow the law and make sure that everyone's voice is heard. And that's what I think I can do and bring best to the table and to the courthouse.
So we're two lawyers having this conversation, but I know that we have a lot of non-attorneys listening here. And I guess my question is how can people that aren't really involved in the legal system, they're not in court on a regular basis, how in the world can they know if someone's going to be a good judge or a bad judge or a fair judge?
Well, I think asking around to other people who they know helps. You could ask other attorneys. Some people say, well, the attorneys are just going to stick with their attorney friends mm-hmm. or their country club friends. But I think asking other people who have been in the courthouse, mm-hmm. what do you think about this person? Someone who maybe isn't a lawyer might have a better way of saying, you know what? Even though she was against me, she was still really, she was polite, she was professional, or she wasn't. But I think that's important. And knowing how someone is in the community, if they have gotten involved and helped other people in the community, I would say that should translate well to the courthouse, and their behavior and their demeanor towards others, who perhaps don't have as much resources as others.
Is there a judge or a short list of judges that you particularly admire?
Well, I think I like Judge Rhonda Holloman. I think she's extremely smart. I appreciate, because she's been in small claims and landlord-tenant mm-hmm. cases, how much she is really respectful of everyone. There are so many people who go in pro se, that is, without an attorney. And you can tell that she treats them just as equally as she treats the attorneys that are in suit coats and very expensive suits. And so I think I admire that a lot. I admire her intelligence. So I think she's one of the attorneys that I really look up to.
And she's also here in Champaign County. Mm-hmm. So if you can make any changes to Champaign County judicial system, what changes would you make?
Well, I think there are making sure that people understand their rights better. And so part of that might be in going out and speaking in the community about knowing your rights in court. I would be happy to, as a judge, go out and talk with, do public forums like at the libraries or at the high schools about these are your rights. This is what you should know about going to court. One of the things that I've learned in helping out and volunteering at the free legal clinic I helped start for immigrants is that especially immigrants who haven't grown up sort of with Law and Order and these sorts of other judge shows, a lot of people don't understand what happens. I've got a summons to appear in court, or I've got to go for a traffic citation. Am I going to go to jail? That sort of thing. And so helping people understand sort of, okay, don't worry, this is what's going to happen, but you really do need to go or you don't. And I get a lot of questions from people who just know that I'm a lawyer. Okay, what am I supposed to do on this? And so I can sort of explain to them those sorts of things. I think also helping people to understand about bond payments and how to handle those, and whether bail bonds or what amount is really necessary, and sort of the important information that a judge needs to have, whether it's reducing a bond or factors sort of in aggravation and in mitigation that you have in criminal cases.
I know that there was the expungement mm-hmm. Pro bono clinic that there was going on. Do you think that there's more activities like that that could help promote more pro bono activities in our county?
There's that. There's, as I mentioned earlier, I helped to start a free legal clinic for immigrants when I noticed such an increasing number of Spanish-speaking immigrants coming to my office and just asking for help. In fact, even stopping me in the mall and saying, ¿Tú eres la abogada Ruth? ¿Puedes ayudarme? And so I thought, well, we need to do this. And so I continue to volunteer there every month. And then when they have urgent needs for immigrants that can't wait for the next clinic, then they contact me and I help them. But I think having more people know about that they can volunteer in these for these opportunities, because there's always more people who need help who just have questions that need to be answered.
Right. How do you do it all, Ruth? How do you juggle it all? Any tips for our viewers on managing that work-life balance?
I think it's hard. And I think, as you know, in family law cases, you take a case and you think, oh, this will be easy. This is what we'll do. And then something explodes and there's a fight and there's an order of protection and that sort of thing. So part of it is trying to fit in or schedule time where there was not anything planned, so you can sort of catch up and explain things. I certainly think that the cell phones and being able to work from home help a lot. Mm-hmm. So I do, when after my daughter goes to bed, I'll work for a couple hours, and that helps a lot. And then I think, frankly, getting to know other attorneys and so being able to bounce issues and ideas off of them, I think helps a lot. You go to court, and it doesn't always have to be so contentious. Or if it's contentious with one side, well, at least you'll see some other friends who maybe you've had other cases against, but at least you respect, they respect you, and you can talk with them about cases and hopefully try to resolve them as well, or at least get some feedback on them.
What has been your biggest challenge as an attorney in private practice?
Well, I think it is figuring out how much pro bono work you can do and still pay the staff and still pay the rent and the insurance, and then hopefully take some money home for yourself to pay your own mortgage. And it's that balance, because as attorneys, most of us just want to help other people. And how do you say, no, I can't do it, or you know what, I can't do this much, can you come back next month? That's really hard. And so that affects certainly the work-life balance and, frankly, the campaign and life balance as well. But figuring out how to do some things even more efficiently as well so that you can help more people.
So how are you juggling all this in addition to running for office?
That's been hard. But it's interesting, and it's actually very comforting that a lot of the clients that I've had in the past, or even that I currently have, are supporting me, have said, oh, I'll support you, put up signs, and greet me at the farmer's market when we've had the farmer's market. So it's really nice to see that sort of approval from people who you have represented, and that even if you didn't get everything for the client that you wished you had gotten and that they wanted you to get, that they still know that you tried really hard and know that you've got a good heart and that you'll do this.
How do judicial campaigns work? And for our listeners that are interested in getting involved in specifically in your campaign, what should they do?
Sure. Well, they can certainly contact me through our website, www.wyman4circuitjudge.org, and you can email me through the website, and we'd be happy to set you up, whether it's taking a yard sign, talking with friends and neighbors, going door to door, coming to a coffee, even making a contribution if people wanted to. But so it's looking at it's that, but it's trying to weave in different opportunities to talk with people. I was at the farmers market in Urbana almost every Saturday morning this summer. We've got some coffee and conversations scheduled for Picara and for the Common Ground Food Co-op, so people can come and talk with me, and so we can sort of just answer questions and talk about ideas and concerns.
What have been the biggest surprises in your path into judgeship and with your campaign?
I think actually the outpouring of support. I was really worried that people wouldn't really want to support, or they'd be nervous, but I'm impressed. I think that we've gotten more donations for my campaign than the other three candidates combined. And they've ranged actually from like a dollar up to a few thousand dollars from non-family members. So that's been very, very heartening. Probably the most is seeing all the people who want to take yard signs and publicly declare they're supporting Ruth Wyman for judge. And so that's always fun and nice to see. And then just talking with people and them just saying, hey, good luck, I'm voting for you. And it's very nice, the sort of endorsements that people have done either through the website or simply just, you know, way to go and atta girl type support.
All right. Well, I am going to be interviewing Ruth a few more times, and we're going to be both accepting questions. If any of you have any questions for Ruth or running for judge, feel free to email myself or Ruth. My email is Cari, C-A-R-I, at rinkerlaw.com. And Ruth, do you want to go ahead and state your email?
Sure. Probably the best way is to go through the website and email me through the website, www.wyman4circuitjudge.org. The four is the number four. And I'd be happy to answer those questions either in our conversations or separately through email.
I know you have a pretty active Facebook group. Do you have a handle for that?
That is something, it's brand new to me. I didn't have a Facebook page before we started the campaign, so I'm still learning the ins and outs and not used to checking it as often as I think some people do.
But you can find Ruth Wyman's campaign page, Champaign page also on Facebook, and me also with my handle at Cari Rincker. So thanks again for listening. Until next time.
Thank you.